fix my laptop here on this cushion. All right. There you go. You see me any better? Probably doesn't matter. Sun's coming out a little bit better. Differences in style between Genesis chapters 1 and 2 demand neither different authors, nor conflicting accounts, nor the conclusion that the Bible is not reliable. We've just looked at a number of these things. We're summarizing now. We're going to move on to Genesis chapter 2 and take a look at the first four verses to see if they're not part of chapter 1, which they are. Critics of God's Word advance their criticism of the Bible by making the grand assumption, with no substantive evidence, that there were a number of writers, compilers of the book of Genesis, who did not intend to make sense with what they arrived at, despite contradictions, which the critics allege are evident. So the critics claim that the writers, compilers, circulated their work without any effort to reconcile anything. The critics maintain that this permitted what the critics view as irreconcilable contradictions, especially throughout Genesis chapters 1 and 2. And these alleged irreconcilable contradictions could then be used to openly refute God's word without any viable defense whatsoever. So that's why I've given you all these details with a lot of repetition. This is probably one of the first few things that people are going to say, the nonsense between Genesis chapters 1 and 2. However, this alleged problem with the Bible's reliability is resolved with an honest, objective reading of Genesis chapters 1 and 2, strictly in accordance with the normative rules of language, context, and logic. You can click on that and get a rule, but if you've learned to do reading properly, you know you start at the beginning and work your way through to the end and take notes and realize that words can have more than one meaning, so apply the proper meaning to the proper context. For an honest reading of God's Word reveals a wholly reliable, consistent meaning that completely upholds itself as reliable, without contradiction, error, or loose ends. So is the Bible reliable? Yes, not because it says it is, but it is, but because you proved it out to yourself by following the right principles of reading, language, context, and logic. Other people will come up with some wacky ideas about it, and wow, wait a minute, we're both reading the Bible. How come you have a crazy idea and I have one that I think is logical? Well, because you're not reading it properly, you're going to come up with anything. You can read anything, even newspaper articles, and find out that really Trump did win the election. Really. All the while, an honest reading of God's Word completely refutes what the critics have continually claimed against the Bible, such as what they assert Genesis chapters 1 and 2 convey that is contradictory. So the problem lies not with the words of God's Word, but with how the critics or anyone interprets those words. How many times you say, that's not what I said? Well, I don't care because I think I know what you said. Well, can I correct that? No. Well, okay, we got a problem. The context of Genesis chapter 1 is panoramic and broad. The context of Genesis chapter 2 is a mixed close-up view of a person in a particular time frame, which was presented in Genesis chapter 1, namely the sixth day of creation, and the man whom Jehovah God created, Adam. And this view includes minutiae detail, such as the names and locations of four river tributaries, a specific garden which God planted, and then placed into it the man he had formed. Minutiae detail. The fact that Adam needed a mate, the naming of specific animals and birds also. The critics incorrectly assume that both chapters attempt to present the same events, but use different styles to do this. The critics claim that the style of chapter 1 is stereotype, measured and precise, with a recurring formulae, such as the repetitive use of the verb to create is correct. I'm not going to argue that. It's what it is. This is because the subject matter and perspective of the chapter is more stereotype, measured and precise, with recurring formula, such as the repetitive use of the verb to create. I'm a scientist. I do all these formula. Now I get to the point of describing to people, to publish my works, exactly what that work entails in prose or in letters, in written paragraphs. One is stereotype, measured and precise because they're formula. The other is an explanation for the layman. It's a little more fluid, picturesque. Okay. Not two different authors, same person. So since chapter 2's subject and focus is more diversified and picturesque, a more diversified, picturesque style without recurring formulae, would be the most appropriate style for Moses to use. Another writer would not be needed to write chapter 2 because of the different style. God just simply inspired Moses to utilize the appropriate style to correspond to changes in the context. Most accomplished writers do this today when the context dictates it. Refer to a local newspaper, a favorite novel, even a history book, On the other hand, many of the other claims of the critics, such as Chapter 2 is notably fresher, more spontaneous, and primitive as compared to Chapter 1, are imaginary. Only in one's imagination could a claim be more substantiated that Chapter 1 is not spontaneous or fresh or primitive. What could be more spontaneous, primitive, and fresh than Chapter 1 of Genesis 1, which begins, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light." The style differences have no weight as an argument, and simply reflect changes in subject matter. Point 2. Critics claim that anthropomorphic references to God described as exemplifying human behaviorisms in Genesis chapter 2, who fashions, breathes, plans, takes, sets, brings, closes up, builds, walks, contradicts the God of Genesis chapter 1. Why? Well, the critics have quite a superficial argument here. Man in his finite mind cannot express ideas about God in anything but through anthropomorphism. Furthermore, God is not talking over man's head. He's talking to man and gives you verbs a man would understand. Furthermore, and besides, they're accurate. Furthermore, chapter 1 of Genesis also expresses God in such equally anthropomorphic terms as called, saw, blessed, deliberated, verse 26, let us make. God worked for 6 days and he rested. So, if you have a problem with chapter 1, you have a problem with chapter 2. So, chapter 2's lack of reference to man being created in the image of God contradicts chapter 1. No. But the critics assume beforehand that chapters 1 and 2 are the two separate accounts of the overall creation process, which someone attempted to hook together. Actually, they're both correct. God created out of materials formed in the earth that already were created out of nothing. That's the body. Now the soul and the spirit of man, God created out of nothing. Both together creates the whole man, body, soul, and spirit. They ignore the simplest and most obvious interpretation that chapter 2 is just a continuation of chapter 1 by the same author, providing more detail in a narrower and more focused area of what chapter 1 has already presented, from a panoramic to a close-up and detailed account. The narrower and close focus often demands, a closer focus often demands, a change in verb tenses and person and more details, but without having to replicate details covered. A change of authors is not needed to be made to do this. We've done stuff like that at home. You talk to your parents or you talk to your children in different ways. In this case, if this is the case, and it is, then chapter 2, being a continuation of what was already stated in chapter 1, does not need to repeat what was just stated in chapter 1 relative to such things like man being created in the image of God. Okay, now let's verify this. Let's go into chapter 2 again and refocus, repeat, and see what chapter 2 has to say to see if I've missed anything. All right. Now we looked at excerpt from Genesis chapter 1 already, so we could skip that. We just read through it. Begin at Genesis 2, 1 to 4. Which is really Genesis chapter 1, the end. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them are finished, in perfect tense, are being finished. Okay? Well, didn't we just finish reading that? And God completed by the seventh day his day, his work, which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. Well, wait a minute. We got 6 days in chapter 1 and we're seventh day in chapter 2. Well, I think that if these writers were able to put in their own chapter headings and verse numbers, they would have done it differently. It would have said Genesis chapter 1 and finished it off instead of Genesis chapter 2, which people did later. They weren't the writers. They were the editors. And they organized it all right. And if you read the context, you're not going to have a problem with it. So then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created and made, literally to make. These are the accounts of the heavens and the earth which they were created in the day that the Lord God made earth and in the heavens. Is he finishing off chapter 1, or is he going to begin again in chapter 2 with something different? Obviously, he's finished off chapter 1. It's contiguous. So that's Genesis 2, 4. So, we've just read 2, 1 to 3. Let's not reread it again. So Genesis 2:1, thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them are finished in perfect tense stipulates the completion of Elohim's work delineated in Genesis chapter 1 of the creation of the heavens, the earth, and the host of them, the last phrase referring to heavenly bodies, especially the stars. Genesis 2:2, and God completed by the seventh day his work which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made, refers to Elohim having completed his work of creating the heavens and the earth and all the heavenly bodies by the seventh day, in the sense that his work was finished through the sixth day, and he rested, ceased his creative work on the seventh day. We're not looking forward, we're looking back to what he had just done, obviously. Hence, there were created no other universes, nor more parts of the one universe, as some contend. On the other hand, this is not to say that God ceased working, for the contexts that follow throughout Scripture indicate that God gave himself to a new work of upholding his creation and carrying out his plan of redemption through his Son, Jesus Christ. So God, Elohim, rested on the seventh day from his creative work, a day which it is implied is of the same duration as each of the previous 6 days. So people try to read all this stuff in there, take it as it says, and then if there's something unusual, figure out why it would be unusual. There are no words to make it any more unusual. It's just as it's read. For no distinction is specifically made that the seventh day is any different with respect to duration than the 6 previous 24 days of creation work. By the way, if God rested from his on the seventh day, and that's millions of years, well, then of course it says, well, why wouldn't the first 6 days be the same, many, many more, but there's an evening and a morning. Man would only understand something when an evening morning is a 24-hour day. It's not billions of years. Which part of the billions of years is an evening, which is a morning? That wouldn't make sense. Later, God commanded his people Israel to set this day apart and dedicate it to worshiping him. Oh, okay, this must be a 24-hour day, because if after 6 days of your life you decide to rest for the rest of eternity, then the people would only get to be 6 days old, and then the rest, oh, well, I'm resting now, which limits that day to 24-hour day, like the 6 days of creation, Exodus 20:11. So the fact that the seventh day is not formally summarized, as are the other 6 days at the end of each day, certainly does not mean that the seventh day is still continuing, as some day-age advocates have suggested. The scripture does not say he is resting on the seventh day, but rather he rested, past tense, on the seventh day, Exodus 31:17. Even says that on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed, all past tenses. Though his work of creation was finished, he very soon had to undertake the great work of redemption because of what man did in the garden and then thereafter. In Genesis 2:3 it states, then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. Had created, perfect. Point in time, done deal, and made, or literally to make. God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it in the sense of setting it apart from the 6 days of creation to commemorate the completion, the cessation of his creative work. So we're looking back. We're not looking forward, as some contend. 4 times throughout Genesis 2:1-3 it is noted, hence emphasized, that God finished, completed, rested from his creative work. Got to get that through your head. Hence, this commemoration was to bring attention to God's perfect creation and to its perfect creator. So we don't need another account of creation after this in Genesis chapter 2. It's just giving you details of what he had already done. The Hebrew word transliterated in English letters, toledos, key word, rendered generations, in the sense of, could be a couple of senses, but in the best context, in the sense of accounts of, is the pivotal word in Genesis 2:4a, the first part of Genesis 2:4, which by way of a summary statement concludes the context of the 6 days of chapter 1, which after which chapter 2, beginning with Genesis 2:4b, turns to details of what had already occurred in chapter 1. Read it again. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them are finished, and God completed by the seventh day his work which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all work, his work which he had made. We're still looking back. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. Still looking back. Now, Genesis 2:4a. These are the accounts of the heavens and the earth which when they were created. Toledot. These are the Toledot, the accounts of the heavens and the earth when they were created. It literally says that. So he's looking back, not what he's going to do next. in the Lord, the day that the Lord God made heaven and the earth.